And this morning, I just felt like last week, what I wanted to do to kind of go a little bit further with this. Let me recount what we've talked about so far. Acts chapter 3, verse 19 and 20 says this. It says, this is Peter preaching. He says, "Repent, therefore, and turn back, that your sins may be blotted out." That's number one, that we repent and get our life right with God. And then it says in verse 20 that times of refreshing may come from the presence of the Lord. And I'm telling you, in my heart, that's what I feel like the church is really needing right now, is a time of refreshing. But it can't get it if we don't trust God and just spend time in His presence and allow the Holy Spirit to work in our lives. You know, that word, I went and looked up that phrase, from the presence of the Lord, and it means from the face of the Lord. In other words, it's like Moses in the Old Testament, he went in that tent of meeting, the Bible says, and the Bible says the Lord spoke to him face to face. Now, I know there's other scriptures that says no one can see the face of God and live, so we don't know exactly all the details of how that worked out. But still, God spoke to him, and His presence was right there with him in such a strong way that it changed Moses forever. I mean, the very radiance and the glory of God was on his countenance. And the Bible says when he came to the people back off out of that tent of meeting, they really couldn't even look at him. Somehow the glory of God, listen now, and this is in your Bible, was like in his skin. And it's like it was just radiating from him. The presence of God, I believe that's what kept him alive and vibrant. That's why he could survive 40 days and 40 nights without food and water twice in the presence of God, because he was in the glorious presence of God. Amen? And when you're in the presence of God, I mean, nothing can die right there. I mean, everything just is sustainable. God sustains us. And when you're in His presence, like we're going to be, you know, that's why we got to have a glorified body, I believe, is because I don't think we can handle the glory and the presence of God just constantly. Okay? It's just so powerful. It's like a presence that could consume us, but instead God uses His presence just to fill us and refresh us. And I think that's so awesome. Another translations talk about it, says times of spiritual strength will come from the Lord. Another translation says, then times will come when the Lord will refresh you. Now, here's the question this morning I felt like I wanted to address. Here it is. How do we keep ourselves in a place with the Lord that will cause His glory and presence to continually be with us? Now, we know that the Lord is with us. Amen. I mean, we know from the Scriptures God is with us all the time. But I'm talking about when you are literally sensing His presence on a daily basis. I don't even know if you guys even know what I'm talking about right now. I'm talking about sensing His presence in your everyday life. I mean, just you can just sense the presence of the Lord. Okay? And you feel that closeness to God. You feel like, man, I can just talk to Him at any moment, and God is right there. You just sense His nearness. And that's what I'm talking about. How do we keep ourselves in a place with the Lord that will cause His glory and presence to continually be with us in such a personal, very intimate way? And here's what I feel like the Lord gave me. And this is what I feel like has been lost in the world and in the church, is the fear of the Lord. The fear of the Lord, okay? And I'm not talking about running, hiding, scared to death of God. I'm talking about such an awesome respect for the Lord that we don't see that in our society anymore. Or maybe not even in the church sometimes. Listen to what this scripture says. It says in Proverbs 3, verses 7 and 8, it says, "Be not wise in your own eyes. Fear the Lord and turn away from evil." Okay? Now listen to what verse 8 says. "It will be what? Healing to your flesh and refreshment to your bones." Okay? And that's what I'm talking about. How do we keep this fresh presence of God in our lives? We need to have a healthy fear of the Lord. Okay? We need to have that. And I want to break this down. He says, first of all, be not wise in your own eyes. In other words, don't think that you've got it together, because you don't. Okay? You don't have it all together. Every day of your life, there's going to be some struggles you go through, okay? And I'm saying, so it says, be not wise in your own eyes. Don't think you've just got everything together and you've got the answer to everything, because you don't. Amen. All right? And so you just have to admit that. That's part of humbling yourself before God. And then he says, and turn away from evil. And do that as well. In other words, that's the constant theme that we see in the Bible. One of the scripture we just looked at, Acts chapter 3 says, it says, repent that your sins may be blotted out, that times of refreshing may come. And then 2 Chronicles 7:14 says, if my people, which are called by my name, will humble themselves and pray, seek my face, turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven. Okay? So you can't have one unless you do the first. And then the middle part of that says, be not wise in your own eyes, but fear the Lord. That's what I want to kind of talk about a little bit this morning. And just, I want to show you the result of doing these things. Not being wise in your own eyes, fearing God, turning away from evil. What's the result? Well, it says it will be healing to your flesh and refreshment to your bones. Amen. I mean, there's just a sense of just, whew, thank you, Jesus. Amen. Well, you're not struggling. You're not anxious. You're not stressed. You can just rest in the Lord. That's what God wants you to be able to do, is just rest in Him. Amen. 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 Let me move on here. Proverbs 19:23 says, the fear of the Lord leads to life, and whoever has it rests satisfied. Yes. He will not be visited by harm. The fear of the Lord leads to life, and whoever has it rests satisfied, and he will not be visited by harm. Why is the fear of the Lord in society so comforting and refreshing when we have it? Okay? Because it's obvious we don't have it right now. All right? If you guys are watching any kind of news, which I would say be careful about how much you do that, because it will get you down unless you see it through God's eyes. All right, and that's what we're going to talk about a little bit this morning, about what's going on in the world and what God, I feel like, maybe he's trying to say to his church, what he's trying to tell to the world, and that we need to understand we've got to have fear of the Lord.
Yes.
Okay? And he says, again, Proverbs 13, the fear of the Lord, it leads to life. Whoever has it rests satisfied. But why is that? Why is the fear of the Lord so comforting to society? I just want to look at some scriptures. I just looked up some scriptures about the fear of the Lord. And the Bible teaches that the fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge. Proverbs 1:7 says, the fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge. Fools despise wisdom and instruction. So the fear of the Lord, that's where it all begins. It is the beginning of everything. When you fear God, if you will make the basis of your life is putting Him first and having an awesome respect and awe of God, then everything else will fall into place, okay? When you fear God, when you trust His Word, when you look to Him, look at Psalm 19:9 here. It's up on the screen. The fear of the Lord is clean. The fear of the Lord is clean. I thought, what does that mean? What does that even phrase? So I had to study that a little bit. But let me just read the verses. The fear of the Lord is clean, enduring the forever. The rules of the Lord are true and righteous altogether. And that word clean means pure. What is that saying? The fear of the Lord brings a purity in your life. The fear of the Lord brings a purity in our culture. That's not there right now. Okay? We know it's not there. Let's be honest, right? We've got to be honest. It's not there. But it says the fear of the Lord is clean, enduring forever. The rules of the Lord are true and righteous altogether. And I want to bring this around now to our nation. Proverbs 14:34 says, righteousness, or purity, if you will, exalts a nation. But sin is a reproach to any people. And what am I trying to say? Well, I'm trying to tie this together to understand that people understand that without the fear of the Lord, okay, you know, it says righteousness exalts a nation. And we decide to do things God's way. That's going to help our nation to rise up and be the nation God wants us to be. But we understand that there is no fear of God in our nation. Okay? Matter of fact, we're trying, in a lot of circles, people are trying to get God out of the picture altogether. Okay? I mean, in any way that we can to get God out of the picture. And especially Jesus Christ. Okay? And so we have to, as Christians, we have to understand that we have got to be refreshed so that we can stand in these days in which we're living. because I'm just saying it is, I don't think it's gonna, it's, I'm just saying it's not gonna get better. Now, I promise you, I would rather preach a feel good, do good message, but I read the scriptures and I see what they say. I'm gonna share some of it with you this morning. I know this is even hard to talk about because it can be kind of depressing in a sense, okay? To see where our nation is heading, okay? Things going on in our nation, things going on in the church, okay, that I would have never dreamed that we would even as a church ever have to deal with. I mean, there's some things that are just plain and cut and dry, but not according to the world anymore. But the world tells the church and God, you need to get relevant. You need to change with the times. But instead, what we need to do is understand God is God, amen, that He has a standard, that He is the beginning and the end. He is the first and last. He sees the whole picture. Amen. And if He already sees the whole picture, then what He says needs to be listened to.
Right.
All right? Because He knows what's right. He knows what's going to satisfy us. He knows everything that the enemy is trying to use to try to confuse people and try to stress people and try to get them thinking this way and that way, thinking that's going to bring them hope and peace and happiness. And it's not. The Bible says plainly that the God of this world has blinded the minds of unbelievers. Wow. Lest the glorious gospel of Christ should come unto them and they be saved.
Amen.
And that's our job.
Right.
That's our part, to present the glorious gospel of Christ to people who are being blinded. Just like, listen, I was. You were at one time. I talked to a man yesterday. We was up in Mentone, Alabama. And this man, I was just talking to him there. He was a Christian. He is a Christian, but didn't always be a Christian. I mean, he had this long, I love the way he looked. He had this long gray hair, straggly beard, but man, you could see in his eyes that he knew Jesus. And when we talked, you could just sense the Holy Spirit in this man's voice, and this is very countenance. He said, I used to hate Christians. That's what he said. I used to hate Christians, and now I am one. Praise God, because he was blinded. Just like so many people are, just like we were at one time. So we have got to be that light. We've got, and we can't be cowering down and fearing down and running and hiding in some cage somewhere, saying, let's get in the four walls of the church and let's hide, and maybe it all pass over. Okay, we've got to make a stand for the Lord. And listen, when you do that, it's not going to be popular. People's not saying, oh, bless your heart. Okay, it's going to be more in the days of the coming, people that in your face, you know, you and just calling you a bigot and everything else. Okay, how can you be so narrow-minded? Okay, to believe that you know the way and everybody else believes this, and do you think you've got the only way? Listen, we've got to be willing and ready to answer those questions. Okay, why do we believe what we believe, and do it with love and compassion, not with, you know, condemnation? So, anyway, let me move on here. The fear of the Lord. The fear of the Lord. And let me just say this. I feel like God is trying to bring the fear of the Lord back into the church. Okay? Because I think the Lord's getting ready to, I don't know. I'm never one to say I'm going to predict when Jesus is coming, but I'm telling you, well, the signs of the times are just all around us. But it's almost like God is trying to get the church ready for just something powerful that can happen and giving this world an opportunity once again to come to Him before God just says, okay, the time of the Gentiles is done. In other words, Romans, I believe it's chapter 11, talks about until the time of the Gentiles is fulfilled. What does that mean? It means that God was working with Israel. Jesus, when he came to this earth, he went to the people of Israel. They rejected him. God knew that they were going to reject him, even in the Old Testament prophecies, that he would be a light to the Gentiles. But then it says there's coming a point where this light to the Gentiles, this time with the Gentiles will come to an end, and then God will once again address his attention back toward Israel. And he's always kept his eye on Israel. He always has. There's coming a time when he's going to, like Daniel chapter 7, we'll talk about this in our Wednesday night teachings we're doing in the last days. But we'll talk about that when God's going to refocus his attention back onto Israel. Once again, this last seven-year period, the Bible calls the tribulation period, is all going to be about reestablishing and bringing Israel back to where they're supposed to be with God. But let me tell you, Israel's not where it needs to be with God at all. Well, I used to have this understanding and this false conception that if you were a Jewish person, that you loved God, you knew God. And that's not it at all. That's not it at all. Now, there are people, this is the exciting part, there are people coming literally by the thousands now. When Israel first became a nation in 1948, literally it was less than 10. Now there's thousands that have been coming to Christ. And so I'm telling you, God is already doing the work among his people. But I think it's like God is trying to get the church to say, if you're away from me, it's time to get back right with me.
Amen.
I think that God is trying to speak to the church throughout the world, you know, through all this that's going on. Okay? And he's trying to get the church to come back. We got work to do. Okay, I need you to be refreshed. I need you to be filled. I need you to be ready to share the gospel. Okay? You know when the church grew the most, matter of fact, in the Bible, is when it was persecuted. History, if you go back and study history, it's when the church was persecuted, that's when the church grew the most. You know why? Because people had to decide, am I in this or am I out of this? I'm either for real or I'm not for real. Okay, it's almost like a sifting. Okay, a sifting of the church. In other words, find out who's really serious about this and who's just on the fringes. You know, just, okay, if this satisfies my needs and all this, and if it all works for me, then I'll do it. Okay? It's not about what you do. It's about what you're doing for God. Okay? It's not about what you are doing with your own life and just trying to get comfortable and satisfied. You've got to come to the place where Jesus said, if you're going to follow me, you've got to take up your cross daily. Okay? And follow after him. I know this is not popular preaching.
Come on.
This is not seven steps to happiness. Okay? Alright? It's not that, but it's the truth. We've got to get a fear of the Lord. Let me just share real quick a few reasons why we need to fear the Lord in our culture and in our society. Here's just some of the things I come up with, some scriptures I looked up. First of all, number one, when there's a fear of the Lord, there's an emphasis on the sacredness and sanctity of life. The sanctity of life. When there is no fear of the Lord, it will cause people to fear for their life. Let me give you an example in the Bible. Abraham, he lied about his wife Sarah. Did this twice, actually. And I want to explain why he did this. But he lied because she was a very beautiful woman. And he entered this place called Gerar, which was a city of the Philistines, which is modern day, what we know as the Gaza Strip today. Okay, well, as a matter of fact, they just shot a missile into Israel just the other day, this week, I think it was, last week. But anyway, so it was the Philistine people, and so Abraham was going through this city, and he says, I need you to lie about who you are. Don't tell them you're my wife, okay? And then, so that's what they agreed to do. Then it was found out that he was, or she was his wife, and so he was approached by that king. And Abraham said this in Genesis chapter 20, verse 11. He said, I did it because I thought there is no fear of God at all in this place. And they will kill me because of my wife. Okay? And so what that tells me is when there is a fear of the Lord, it will cause people to know that life matters to God. Okay? There's a sanctity of life. He said, I was fearful that there was no fear of the Lord here, so I thought life didn't have any meaning. Okay? I figured my life was just, you know, nothing. Alright? And if there's no fear of God, life does become nothing.
Right.
We can see that in our culture. We can see that when there's no fear of the Lord, it's so easy for people to kill someone else or slaughter babies or whatever it is, you know, and all the things we have to deal with, abortions and things like this. And listen, I realize that abortion is a very sensitive issue, but still we need to understand that it is wrong. Okay, it's sensitive. It is sensitive. If you have one, you know, I know God can heal you there. God can forgive you anything. Okay, he can. He really can. So please don't feel like I'm condemning you. But at the same time, we can't just say, you know what, it's okay. Because it's not okay. It's life. God says to Jeremiah, I knew you while you were in your mother's womb. I formed you. I knit you together. God knows us well beyond before we actually come out and birth, okay? And that's the fear of God that says, because I value life, I will not take life. You hear what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
Are y'all with me?
Yeah.
So that's one thing the fear of the Lord produces. It produces scriptures just a value and a sanctity in life. Point number two, when the fear of the Lord, it affects how we treat others. I think we all know that. But Leviticus says this, I'll give you a scripture, Leviticus 25:17 says, "You shall not wrong one another, but you shall fear your God, for I am the Lord your God." In other words, don't fear, don't do your brother or don't do this person wrong because I'm going to be watching. Okay, and I'm going to hold you accountable. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
And the church needs to hear that again.
Amen.
All right, and the world needs to hear that, but the world ain't listening.
That's right.
All right? And sometimes the church ain't listening either. But when there's the fear of the Lord, it affects how we treat each other. You shall not wrong one another, but you shall fear your God. So what is he saying? When you fear me, you will not wrong one another, each other. But if you are wronging each other, you better fear me. Because I'm going to hold you accountable for that. Number three, when there's fear of the Lord, I'm just giving the scriptures. When there's fear of the Lord, it provides honest and integrity-driven leadership. Exodus 18:21 says this, "Moreover, look for able men from all the people, men who fear God, who are trustworthy, and hate a bribe. And place such men over the people as chiefs of thousands, of hundreds, of fifties, and of tens." Listen to what it says. Look for people that fear God, who are trustworthy and hate a bribe. Wouldn't it be great to have some of those folks in our political system right now? Come on now. I'm with you. I hate the politics. And I see it in everything that's going on right now. I see it, and it's about, and please understand, I know we look, okay, here's one side, here's the other side, this party, that party, but it's not about parties. It's the spiritual battle going on for the soul of this nation, and we need to hear that because we need to be the ones praying and seeking God on behalf of our nation, okay, and standing up for right even when it's not popular, okay, and I'm telling you, it's not, you've already seen it, living for God and doing what's right and having values is not popular anymore. It used to be, and I'm not that old, okay, come on. But I can remember when I was in high school that if you were doing the drugs, if you were going out doing the party, you were the one that was the outcast. But it's totally flipped around. If you're not having sex before you're married, if you're not doing the drugs, then you're the outcast. And it's totally flipped around. The Bible says in the last days that we'll call evil good and good evil. And boy, we're seeing that. We're seeing things that used to be called evil good. And just the opposite. We're seeing things that should be called good and evil. Because there's no fear of the Lord. It affects how we treat one another. Honesty and integrity. Okay, how we treat each other is so important. The fear of the Lord. And I'm just listing a few things that I just wanted to share with you. When there's fear of the Lord, it will cause us to hate evil. You know the Bible says that? I'm going to give it to you. Proverbs 8:13 says, "The fear of the Lord is hatred of evil." Now, I'm not saying hatred of people. I didn't say that. It's not hatred of people, but it is hatred of evil. And evil just flows through people. So sometimes it's hard to separate. And that's why we have to understand the scripture says our battle is not with flesh and blood, but against principalities and powers and strong spiritual darkness in high places. We understand that. The fear of the Lord, though, is to hate evil. But it should make you sick when you see evil going on. And if it doesn't, let me just tell you, I feel like this is happening in church. The church has gotten numb. We've gotten numb to it. It's like because we hear it so much, we just don't even think about it anymore. Flip a channel, oh, someone else just got killed. Come on now, we don't even think about it anymore. And we're just getting on to it. There's got to be a point where we have such a fear of God that grips us once again that we hate evil. We hate seeing people get killed. We hate seeing people done wrong. Okay? And if everyone had that, then things would be right. But people now, it's all about what I want, what satisfies me. And so, because there's no fear of the Lord. Fifth thing, when there's fear of the Lord, it will keep the needy from being taken advantage of. This says, 19:14 says, "You shall not curse the deaf or put a stumbling block before the blind, but you shall fear your God. I am the Lord." What is he saying? Don't take advantage of people. People that can't even help themselves. Don't you dare go out and take advantage of them. But that's happening every single day. People take advantage of the elderly. All the stuff that's going on, all the scamming that they're doing to the elderly people. And just there's so many different ways that people are just taking advantage of people today. But when there's fear of the Lord, God says, if you have the fear of the Lord, that won't be happening. So what I'm saying is I'm showing you things to show that there is no fear of the Lord. Mm-hmm. Number six, and this is for our senior brothers and sisters. When there's fear of the Lord, it will make you respect your elders. Yes. That's something that's kind of lost in society.
Yeah.
Leviticus 19:32 says, "You shall stand up before the gray head and honor the face of an old man. And you shall fear your God. I am the Lord." You shall stand up before the gray head and honor the face of an old man. And you shall fear your God. I am the Lord. In other words, God said, respect your elders. Respect those in front of you and those who have trodden the path. And I know how young people think. Because I was one time, years ago. I thought I knew it all. "Mama, you don't know nothing. I'll just go live with my dad." Come on now. I come from a divorce family. 10 years old. I didn't like the way Mama had some rules and guidelines, so I said, "Mom, forget it. I'm going to go live with Dad." I thought it's going to be good next. And I go to Dad's every other weekend. I get ice cream. And, you know, he's always kind of talk. I got to Dad's. It wasn't ice cream. Dad said, "Boy, you better straighten up. I want to go back to Mom's, okay?" I know how it works. Because your parents, as parents, and we're talking about Father's Day, we do things because we have been through some things. We see the end road of what that's going to lead to. And we're trying to save you some trouble. Okay? And so respect that. Now, you know, those people that are godly, you know, and your godly brothers and sisters in Christ, respect them. And show them honor and respect. Okay? We should respect them. And it says, we have the fear of the Lord, we will do that. We will respect our elders. That's so important. You see an elderly person, and I'm sure a lot of you already do this, but man, if you see an elderly person come into somewhere and they don't have a place to sit, give them your seat.
Amen.
If they're coming up to the door, open the door for them. Don't go in the door, just hear they come on their walker and they can't quite keep up with you. Wait up another minute. Open the door for them. Show some respect. These are the people that have built our country. These were the God-fearing culture. You know, that's kind of been lost because our elders are going, "What in the world has happened to our world?" They're going, "Where is God at anymore in our society?" And so they're just looked at as being old-fashioned, out of date, not relevant, but they're more relevant than anyone. Amen?
Right.
All right, my seniors, come on, help me out, man. To help you out. Amen. So does it seem like we have the fear of the Lord in our nation right now? Let's be honest, no, we don't. Now let me say this. God has a way to get the attention of a nation. I'll show you one place he did it. When I was reading this through the book of Exodus, we'd already got here and we're talking about the seventh plague, which was hell. And God was delivering his people out of Israel, and he sent one plague after another. Pharaoh kept hardening his heart and would not let the people go. We got to the seventh one. I mean, seven. All right. All these things had already happened. And still, listen to what it says. Exodus chapter 9, verse 30. "But as for you and your servants," and this is God through Moses speaking to Pharaoh, "but as for you and your servants, I know that you do not yet fear the Lord." I mean, they'd already seen plague after plague after plague, and yet they still did not fear the Lord. I'm telling you, that's the nature of man.
Mm-hmm.
And let me just ask you this. Could it be that God is trying to get the attention of the world before he has to bring his judgment to bear?
Yeah.
Could it be? That time will come. We know the Bible talks about it. It happened before. It's going to happen again. Genesis 6:5 says this, "The Lord saw that the wickedness of man was great in the earth, that every intention of the thoughts of his heart was only evil continually." Now, I'm not up here saying there's not any good people in the world. I'm not saying that at all. Okay? Because there are. There's a lot of good people, and there were a lot of good things that are happening. But I'm just saying we're starting to see things starting to change over. I mean, beyond just starting to see. Okay? Are you with me? Do you hear what I'm talking about? Can you imagine what it was for Noah? God says, "I'm about to destroy the earth, and there's only one person that I could find." That's amazing to me. Only one person. But God used Noah to try to get the attention of the world. You know, the Bible says Noah was a preacher. He preached. I'll give you the scripture, 2 Peter chapter 2, verses 4 and 5. "For God did not spare the ancient world, but saved Noah, one of eight people, a preacher of righteousness, bringing in the flood on the world of the ungodly." Okay, so what is he saying? Noah was out there doing what seemed like an impossible task sometimes. I know sometimes as we as Christians, we think, I think people kind of look at us as Noah, like a Noah. You believe that this guy's going to come back from heaven one day? That sounds kind of, crazy. All right? And we're out here kind of like Noah. We're trying to say, hey, here's an ark. Jesus is the ark, right? Jesus is the ark. We're trying to get you to him so that you can come to a place of safety before this flood comes and wipes you out. Because there is going to come, the Bible teaches that there is going to be a judgment on this world. It's not going to do it by water. Peter actually talks about it have to do with fire. Okay? But still, that's going to happen at some point. And I just want to just, and again, I hate to sound like a doom and gloom, but I just feel like I've got to share this with you. God is using the church now like he was using Noah. Listen to what it says in Matthew 24:36-39. We lose our screen. That's all right. Y'all just listen real good. Matthew 24:36-39 says, "But concerning that day," what day is it talking about? The day when Jesus comes back and establishes his kingdom. "But concerning that day and hour, no one knows, not even the angels of heaven nor the Son, but the Father only. For as were the days of Noah, so will be the coming of the Son of Man. For as in the days before the flood they were eating and drinking, marrying and giving in marriage, until the day when Noah entered the ark." Let me just pause right here. It's got to be soon because people aren't even getting married anymore. You know what I'm saying? Marrying and giving in marriage. And we're saying I respect, I love you guys that are getting married and are willing to get some counseling and doing it God before God. I respect that with all my heart. And God honors that. And I encourage you, make sure you build your marriage on the Lord. Build your marriage on him. Okay? Because that is the only way to go. You know, Teresa and I, we got married, and this is me for Jordan Paisley, and is Sarah still in here? She walked out. Okay, but anyway, I remember when I actually preached at our wedding. It wasn't a long message, I preached out of Building Your House on the Rock. You know, so storms will come, and that house will stand firm. Okay, when you built it on the rock. And I just told the people, it was a statement of faith, it was a statement of my heart, but the trees that I built, decided to build our house on Jesus Christ. The true rock. I'm telling you, it makes a difference. 34 years later, I plan on dying that morning. Okay, I plan on us getting old together, for the Lord tarries. If the Lord takes anyone, I hope he takes me first. That's just me. She probably say, "I will hope he takes you." I don't know what she'll say. You see, we have that kind of relationship. I'm just saying, build your house, build your life, build your marriage on God's word. He will not treat you wrong. He will never lead you astray. Anyway, let me get back to what I was saying. But concerning that day now, no one knows. Okay, whereas were the days of Noah, so shall be the coming of the Son of Man. For as in those days before the flood, they were eating, drinking, marrying, giving marriage until the day Noah entered into the ark, and they were unaware until the flood came and swept them all away. So will be the coming of the Son of Man. Those are not my words, those are the Lord's words. Just as it was, things will be going on, this will be happening, that will be happening, carrying on, whatever. But the people, just unaware, ignorant really, okay, until the flood came. You know, they saw Noah building a boat out in the middle of the wherever. The Bible scholars teach and has shared this, that the closest body of water, or even to put a boat in, was probably about at least 100 miles away. So, you're thinking, Noah, you know, he could have built a little bit closer to the water. You know, but Noah's out there preaching, there's a flood coming. There's a flood coming. And people, I'm sure, they ridiculed him until the day that it started raining. Did you know the Bible says that it had never rained on the earth up to that point? People had never even seen rain. The water would come from underneath and water the earth. They never even seen rain. I'm talking about it came some rain, folks. And don't you know there was people, after they sealed that boat, that were probably scratching the sides of that boat trying to get in. I can't even imagine what that must have been like. Noah was right. Noah was right. What in the world's going on? But then it was too late. And Jesus said it's going to be that way when he comes. We're going to be the churches. We're like in the days of Noah. We're trying to tell people Jesus is coming. It's time to get right. It's time to get in the ark. Okay? Get in the ark. There's a flood coming at some point. All right? And so that's what we're doing. People look at you like you're crazy. All right? And God is using the church now, but even, listen, according to the Bible, even it's not going to be enough. Mm-hmm. It's not going to be enough. And again, man, I hope this is not just discouraging you or depressing you. I just want you to see this. The Bible talks about, in the book of Revelation, that these bowls of wrath that are poured out, there's the trumpets that are blown, this is talking about the sixth trumpet of the angel in the book of Revelation. And it says when this trumpet was sounded, there was these three plagues, and it says, listen, a third of mankind was killed. A third of mankind was killed by this fire, this smoke, this brimstone, which came out of their mouths, these creatures, whatever it was. We don't know exactly what they could have been. It says, for their power is in their mouth and in their tails, for their tails are like serpents having heads, and with them they do harm. But listen, but the rest of mankind who were not killed by these plagues did not repent of the works of their hands, that they should not worship demons and idols of gold, silver, brass, stone, and wood, which can neither see nor hear nor walk. And they did not repent of their murders, of their sorceries, or their sexual immorality, or their thefts. Can you imagine that? Going through all of that and still, there's no fear of God. And that's what I'm telling you. If you just look at some of the things happening, especially that happened when there was a lot of rioting going on, that is just a drop in the bucket of what it will be like after Jesus Christ returns. Right. And the church, can you imagine that every single Christian will be gone? Just like that. I mean, just that quick. I got you. I know. I tell you, I'm probably gonna get that back at some point. But anyway, but just like that, and then, imagine for just a moment, there will be not one single believer on the earth. What's that gonna be? You talking about chaos? You talking about anarchy? You talking about until the man of peace comes and he says, "Oh, I've got the answer." This man of peace, Bible, first one is the Antichrist. But listen, it says that was the sixth angel, but I will leave this on a good point. There was a seventh angel. Seventh angel sounded, and there was loud voices in heaven saying, the kingdoms of this world have become the kingdoms of our Lord and of his Christ, and he shall reign forever and ever. Wow. Revelation 11:18 says, the nations were angry, and your wrath has come. God, you know, people ask sometimes, but I'm like, why does God allow this to happen? You know what I have to say? God is being very gracious to us right now. He's going to see that justice is done. I guarantee that he is. Everybody is going to have to stand before the Lord. Everyone in this room, every one of us, are going to one day have to stand before the Lord and give an account of everything. And what the blessing of a Christian is, even though it's terrible, the things I've done in my life and the things I'm ashamed of, that the blessing is that that day I asked Jesus into my heart, and the blood of that he shed on that cross cleansed me. Didn't cover over it, didn't throw a blanket over it and say, it's still under there. He cleansed me. He washed me. He gave me a different heart. Okay? And I made a choice to live by that new heart that the Lord's given me. Because you can still live by that old sinful nature. It'll try to rise its head up. Try to get you mad and angry and want to cuss people and talk about people and do this to people and try to get revenge to people. That's the old man trying to creep back up. But Mama says we've got to live by this new man, Christ. And that's, you know, and so we are. Christians, we're going to stand before the Lord. As Christians, we'll stand before him. I'll do a preaching or a teaching on this one time. The judgment seat of Christ, when we stand before the Lord, we are judged according to what we did with our salvation. Mm-hmm. And not judged according to whether we're going to heaven or hell, but what did we do with our salvation? What did we do for God? And what, you know, as far as those kind of things go. Not a heaven and hell thing, but just a kind of we stand before the Lord and say, Lord, here it is. Here's what I did. He'll know what you did or didn't do. But then there'll be a final judgment of the wicked. The Bible talks the great white throne judgment there in Revelation chapter 20, where the wicked dead will be standing before the Lord and they'll have to give an account. Okay? Anyway, Revelation 11:18 says, and I'm getting ready to close this, I'm sure you're quite glad. Okay? It says, the nations were angry and your wrath has come. In the time of the dead, that they should be judged, and that you should reward your servants, the prophets, and the saints, and those who fear your name, small and great, and should destroy those who destroy the earth. And so there's a time coming, folks. And the whole message that I'm trying to get across to us this morning is there has to be a fear of God back in the church. There has to be a fear of God. You know, God is trying to get the attention of the world. But I think even more so, I think God's trying to get the attention of his people. I think during this thing that's happening in our in this 2020, we will not soon forget 2020. And I know what everyone in this room, if you're thinking like I'm thinking, you're probably, in the back of your mind, you're probably thinking, what is next? Okay? Come on now. And so we don't know. But that's why I say, don't stress over it. Don't get fearful over it. Take it one day at a time and giving and just living every day for Jesus. Amen? Just every day for Jesus. Because we don't know if we're promised tomorrow. We don't know what's going to happen in any given day. All right, but one thing we do, if we got fear of God, it'll cause us to live right. All right, to live before him, understanding that God, Lord, I think it goes to the point, you know, where you say, serving God is you don't want to displease God as a Christian. I believe you live in such a way where you fear the Lord, but you love him, and you don't want to disappoint him. That's kind of where I'm at, all right? At times, it was just a fear of God. Oh, God, you know, if I mess up, boom! You know, everyone ever think that way about God? It's like, wham! You know, I just, maybe say, wham! And that's kind of what was taught, preached sometimes, and you just, people like petrified. And so there's got to be a balance with that. And the balance is this, is when you love God with all your heart, strength, soul, and mind, you want to honor him. You want to live your way, your life in such a way that pleases him and does not bring shame to his name. That God, anything I do, it just says, Lord, I do this because I want it to bring honor to you. I don't want to do anything or say anything. And we've all made mistakes. We've all done it and felt terrible about it. But the goal is that we don't want to do those things. dishonor his name.
Yeah.
And basically, the Bible says it's like crucifying all over again. Okay, it's like just trampling on what Jesus did every time we just shame him in some way. And so, God help us to have that healthy fear of God. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. I feel like I just beat you up today. I hope I haven't. Okay? But I feel like this is just something. I could go on. I've got about 3-4 pages of notes here. But I'm not going to, you know, it's Father's Day. But I will just say this real quick. I'm not going to read each of these scriptures. I'll just tell you personal applications of having the fear of the Lord in your life. It'll keep you from sinning. It removes the fear of man. Okay? Well, Jesus said, do not fear those who kill the body, but cannot kill the soul, rather fear him who can destroy both soul and body in hell. The fear of the Lord is a fountain of life. The fear of the Lord is a fountain of life that one may turn away from the snares of death. Proverbs 14:27. The fear of the Lord brings mercy, and his mercy is for those who fear him from generation to generation. It provides you with strong confidence. Proverbs 14:26, and the fear of the Lord, one has strong confidence, and his children will have a refuge. What does that mean? Oh, let me just say that real quick. We have strong confidence in our Lord, and hopefully our children will see that as well.
Amen.
So that when they go through their difficult times in life, they can look back at Mom and Dad and say, Mom and Dad trusted God. Now I'm at a point where I need to trust God.
Yes.
And that will be, if you're walking in the fear of the Lord, will have an influence on your children at some point. And also, the fear of the Lord provides God provision. Psalm 34:9, O fear of the Lord, you his saints, for those who fear him have no lack. And Lord, God will provide for all of your needs as long as you put him first. So how do we do this? Philippians 2:12 says this, therefore, my beloved, as you have always obeyed, so now, not only in my presence, but much more in my absence, this is Paul talking. It says, work out your salvation with fear and trembling. For it is God who works in you both to will and to do it for his good pleasure. So as we're walking out our walk with the Lord, we need to do it with the fear of the Lord. Okay? God help us to honor you. Okay? The fear of the Lord is not in the, and we're not seeing that in the world at all. Matter of fact, we're seeing preachers getting beat up. We're seeing, you know, people that has anything that goes against anyone else's agenda, we want to hear it. Okay? But still, there needs to be a fear of God in the church. Amen? Because that fear of the Lord will provide you with refreshing. That's what will keep you next to the Lord. That will keep you strong in the Lord and keep you open where you can receive that refreshing from God. Okay? Is walking your life in purity. Okay? And you can't do that in your own strength, by the way. You've got to rely on the Holy Spirit. You've got to rely on Jesus. You've got to open up your heart. You've got to lift up yourself to the Lord each and every day and just fully give himself, just be naked and bare before God.
Amen.
Don't hold any secrets in. Don't hold anything back. Just lay your soul bare before him and just walk in the fear of the Lord so that his refreshing just can continually come into your life, that there's nothing that blocks God from ministering to you. You think you're hiding things from God? You're not. Somehow, I don't know why we think that. Adam thought he could hide from the Lord. He sinned. He went off and took and grabbed a fig leaf. You know? And God says, Adam, where are you at? God already knew where Adam was at. Alright? But God wanted Adam to see where he was at.
Right.
And he was separated from the Lord. And that's what anything we hold back from God, it keeps us separate. It keeps us from receiving. Let me just put it this way. I'm going to close. As you as a parent, parents, listen to me. Have you ever wanted to do something for one of your children but you couldn't? Because it would be taken the wrong way. What I mean by that? I'm saying there's something you wanted to bless your children, but you couldn't because they may not have been in a place where it was received right. I don't know if I've explained that at all. You know what I'm saying? It's like you wanted to do something, but if you did, it would feel like it would hurt them more than it would help them at that point. Even though you wanted to do it, because there's some things you saw that they needed to learn first. Alright? You saw the whole picture, and you want to do it, but if you do it, it's like, ah. It's kind of kind of like bailing your children out of jail. I don't know if you've ever done that before. My son, I won't mention which one, asked me one day, goes, "Dad, if I get in jail, will you come bail me out?" And I said, "No." I said, "No, I won't." Because, you know, I know it was a joke. But, you know, he was telling me what, he goes, "This is his mind. I'm not going to tell you which one." But anyway, I just told him, because, you know, I know that would not be right for me to go bail him out when he needs a lot less. You know what I'm saying? That's the way God treats us. He's our loving Father, and there's times that He wants to bail you out. He wants to get you out of a situation, but He knows it's going to be better for you to go through that situation. So that you will really learn to trust Him and honor Him.